Good evening, everybody at home, and thank you for joining us virtually here at Robert Gordon's College in the heart of Aberdeen. Tonight, I'm delighted to welcome you to the latest in our Impact webinar series, which is focusing on the crucial theme of neurodiversity. Now, I'm sure you know the drill by now. Webinars like this are so much better if we get lots of audience engagement. So throughout tonight, please do fire in your questions into the Q&A box somewhere down about there on your screen, and we will try to get through as many of them as we possibly can. So we've only got an hour, an awful lot to unpack. So I'm going to begin by introducing two of our three fantastic panelists. And we're going to start by saying hello to Katharine Descamps. Katharine is from the class of 95. She's a Gordonian, and she heads up the challenge program at BP, which is trying to engage in neurodiversity throughout its global network, which is a fantastic initiative. So Katharine, welcome.
Hi, Robin. Thanks a lot. I appreciate the introduction. So just a bit about me. My name is Katharine Descamps. I use the pronouns she, her, and hers. And today, for anyone that's visually impaired joining us, I'm sitting in front of an awesome background that says great minds think differently, because the saying goes great minds think alike, but actually that's not the case in our opinion. I'm wearing a black polo neck and I have long brown hair with lots of freckles. And I was absolutely delighted to be asked to join today's panel by Robin and my former school. So it's great to return and also be joined by really privileged experts in this space. And I'm looking forward to discussing later about neurodiversity and what we're doing in BP. So my personal connection to neurodiversity is my 12-year-old son, Thibaut, who is autistic and ADD. And my personal purpose became my professional purpose to champion inclusion and neurodivergence acceptance in BP. So thank you. And I look forward to sharing more.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, Katharine. And the observant amongst you at home will notice that our second panelist is, in fact, Colin Foley and not Tony Lloyd as advertised. Sadly, Tony indisposed tonight, and Colin has agreed very kindly to step in right at the 11th hour to help us out. He works closely with Tony. He's the training director of the ADHD Foundation, and in the last year alone has organized training for an incredible 13,000 professionals. So welcome tonight, Colin.
Thank you very much, Robert. It's my absolute pleasure to be here. Greetings from Liverpool, everybody. My CEO, as Robin has just said, Dr. Tony Lloyd, sends his absolute apologies. But I was saying to Robin before everyone that Tony's been floored by a cold since this weekend. He rang me up and asked me to do this. He said, whatever you're doing this afternoon, drop it, change it, because I want you to do this, because he really, really welcomed the support that Robin Gordon College gave our umbrella project in the summer. So it's my absolute pleasure to be here, everybody. Thank you very much for attending. Look forward to it.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, Colin. And you will also notice that we've got a third panelist advertised, so hopefully be joining us shortly, because Laura McConnell, who's teacher and campaigner on ADHD, autism and eating disorders, is busy at Scottish Parliament as we speak, doing a bit of lobbying around a policy change and some legislation. So Laura will be joining us shortly. And one thing I should point out, I think Laura's really passionate about, is that any change that we see should be driven by the principle of nothing about us without us. So Laura will be along with us shortly. So please do pop your questions in for our panelists. I've got a couple to get the ball rolling. So Katharine, if I could begin with you, can I please ask you, what kind of skills are BP looking for from the future generation of young people joining the workforce?
Yeah, I'm happy to do that. But just before I do that, to Laura's point about nothing about us without us, I don't speak on behalf of my neurodivergent colleagues at BP. I'm here as an ally and just to share what we've been doing and the amazing work that they've been doing. So in terms of the skills that we look for in BP, they're not unsurprising. And I think neurodiversity can bring many sought after skills that we often underestimate or don't focus on. And so that can be creativity, problem solving, visual and spatial thinking. That's something that I don't have a lot of and benefit from my colleagues' way of thinking. Spatially, long-term memory, big picture thinking. Public speaking was a surprising one. You know, I kind of had the assumption that many of my neurodivergent colleagues had an issue with public speaking, but many ADHD colleagues actually really enjoy public speaking. Attention to detail, hyper-focus as well are some of the traits and skills that we so seek in BP. I just want to add, I think it's about changing the narrative. I think too often we focus on the deficit or the lacking of skills in some of our neurodivergent colleagues, and we need to change the narrative and focus on the skills that they can bring. So that's what we're doing in BP.
Mm-hmm. Can I just ask a follow-up on that, Katharine? So I'm really fascinated by this in terms of recruitment. So how do you go about designing a recruitment process at a big company like BP that perhaps captures that diversity of skill set?
Yeah, so we're working with our recruitment colleagues, but not just our recruitment colleagues, because it's not just the focus. You know, when you have to affect change, you have to affect strategic change. It's not just about changing one part of the recruitment process. It's a wider set of policy changes and process changes. But specifically, we've worked with our early careers team to bring in internships and create internships for the younger neurodivergent colleagues and talent that's joining us. But it's also about, so very specifically, to give you an example, so we're looking at how we change the, so sending out the questions, right, in advance of an interview process is a good example. So, and after, actually, what benefits the minority benefits the majority of people as well, as we found. So typically, we might consider sending out the set of questions that we're going to ask during an interview in advance to give any of our neurodivergent colleagues time to prepare their thoughts, because maybe thinking on the spot and spontaneity is an anxiety inducing behavior that we don't really want to encourage. So we're happy to do that as an example. There are wider sort of processes that we're looking at changing to support the recruitment process as well. We're looking at onboarding, so how we onboard our colleagues, neurodivergent colleagues that come into BP, providing a buddy system. So we have a pretty decent amount of neurodivergence talent in BP already, and we've looked at setting them up a buddy system so they can reach out to anyone that they identify with, and use them as a sort of a mentoring type coaching buddy system. And we've also started to look at line manager training. So a lot of our line managers don't necessarily have the experience of working with neurodivergent colleagues. So we're looking at providing material and guidance. And I think it really comes down to education for us. We've moved away from awareness, because I think industry and society is far more aware of neurodiversity and the value in neurodiversity. It's now about educating people and providing the right materials and training.
Mm-hmm. So all this, I'm fascinating, lots of different issues just in that answer alone. One thing I'd like to ask you, because we'll come on to education, but I've noticed a trend in a lot of companies not asking for 2-1 degrees or first class degrees, because they think that actually they'll capture that kind of broader range of applicants if they go wider than that and get rid of those kind of criteria. Is that something that you've done at BP?
Yes. So in a word, so we've got an apprenticeship program at BP where we offer students that maybe don't want to go to university, and we offer them the opportunity to actually qualify or apprentice and get a degree whilst working for BP as an option. So we've recently set up a social mobility business resource, employee resource group to look at different ways we can provide a route in to BP, despite maybe perhaps the social disadvantages that they may have in accessing a degree level a qualification. So we're looking at different ways. We're also open to discussion around that as well.
Fantastic. Questions coming in already, and I think actually maybe a good time to ask this one from Petra. Are employers allowed to ask if you have neurodiversity or if you're neurodivergent, or how is it brought up?
I'm happy to answer that. I'd be interested in what Colin has experienced as well, because I can only speak, we don't ask. It's up to the individual to share or disclose their neurodivergence if they so wish. So we absolutely, that's not what we ask. So we, on the job adverts, we state that we don't discriminate. And of course, if anyone would like to share any form of neurodivergence or disability or any other information that they feel is relevant, they are free to do so. But no, we don't ask.
Fantastic, thank you. So Colin, if we can broach another really thorny issue, which I think is good to do early on. There's a big national debate around exclusions in schools. So if we know that at the top level, CEOs and entrepreneurs, about 35% of them are estimated to be under that umbrella of neurodiversity. And yet that same population accounts for about 7 out of 10 school exclusions. So if that's the case, how do you explain that? Because that's a really starkly contrasting statistics there.
Yes, it's absolutely fascinating, isn't it, Robin? Can I just say before we start, I'm so sorry, Katharine, about the light going off and then me having to get up and turn the light on. We have paid our bill, everybody, here in the office, but this light is on a timer. It's going to go off again in 20 minutes, so please, everybody, just bear with me. Robin, you're absolutely right. It's so interesting, isn't it, that you have, and nothing's changed in Scotland and England for years and years, overwhelmingly exclusion rates are neurodiverse children and young people. And the very little data we have, both in Scotland and across the UK, about achievement in education tells us that a lot of neurodiverse children and young people underachieve within education. So we have absolute challenges within the education system. But what's going on when they leave? Because you're absolutely right, Robin. I was reading a piece of research recently that said that the percentage of self-made millionaires across the UK who had dyslexia was really, really high. I mean, it speaks to people's absolute resilience, doesn't it? That people, they have had challenges and they have found the education system difficult. And I sometimes talk to parents and carers and say, just get your child through it, get them to survive it. And then, when they go, they'll be fine. But there's something about the nature of neurodiversity here, I think. I always think about ADHD and people that can't wait. So I'm not going to go to this company and wait around for 10 years, make money for somebody else, wait around for somebody to retire and then move up. No, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to set up my own business. I'm going to set up my own company and do it for myself. Okay, there's also if you understand, as Katharine said before, hyper-focus, the power of hyper-focus and what a great asset it is to have that people can absolutely hyper-focus on this vision that they have for this business or this organization, and then they can just run with that. There's risks, of course. I mean, I've known many people, particularly with ADHD, who are real workaholics, who have a really poor work-life balance, who burn themselves out. Mm-hmm. But I always think when I talk about this, about Tony, who's not here this afternoon, and he 14 years ago got involved with this group of parents in Liverpool who wanted some support, and they didn't really know what, for their children with ADHD. 14 years later, we are the largest ADHD neurodiversity charity in Europe, having an impact on the national agenda, all driven by this man with ADHD who absolutely had this vision. And we laugh at him in the office because he comes in and he throws, we call it throwing grenades. He comes in with all these ideas, throws them around the office and then leaves. And he's employed people like me and colleagues to then sit down and go, right, what's the plan and how are we affording this and who's going to do it and when are we going to do it? And it's absolutely playing to your strengths. And I always think that if neurodiverse people get into that right position professionally and they have the support, and you look at organizations like Catherine's just been explaining BP, they can absolutely thrive within the workplace. And it's no surprise to me that you have people who have that entrepreneurial spirit, that vision, that big idea thinking that Katharine was just explaining. But I mean, I know that Robin, we'll probably get onto this, won't we, but there are real real challenges within the workplace. But can I just say this, Robin? I always like to say this when I get in front of a group of parents and carers. And what I'm about to say to everyone, is not taking away for a minute any of the challenges that your sons and daughters might be experiencing right now in school. It absolutely isn't. I'm not naive, okay? But if my experience of the last 7 years doing this job, I lead the training team, I deliver training sessions to professionals. If my experience means anything, it's this. 7 years ago, I was on my own. Nobody wanted to talk about neurodiversity. And the people who did was 100% schools, colleges and universities. Mm-hmm. Now, I would say there's four of us. And 50% of my work now is with businesses and companies. Katharine is absolutely right, is that the awareness now, and what's really exciting is that part of this is being driven by neurodiverse people in the workplace who are saying, I have this diagnosis, I have legal rights, what are you doing? But some of it is about businesses and companies wanting to position themselves and brand themselves to attract the best people. And some of those people are neurodiverse because of the nature of neurodiversity. And also there's 13 million neurodiverse people in the UK. They want to market their goods and services to that audience as well. So education might seem to be running to catch up with other sectors of our society. And I believe that that's the case. In many places, there are outstanding schools out there doing brilliant work. But in large part, education is running to catch up. But the world that your son or daughter is about to embark upon is really changing. And it's changing at a really fast pace. Robin, if I could just give one example of this. Earlier this year, I was asked to deliver a course, me, an old secondary drama teacher, to a missile defense company in the home counties, a new company building weapons and selling weapons. And they said, we want your logo on our website. We want to brand ourselves with you. I said, why? They said, we want the best people to come and work for us. I said, what do you mean the best people? All the hairs on my neck were all standing up thinking, what's going on? They said, you know, these are really skilled, really well-paid engineering jobs. They said, if you put on your CV that you have the qualifications and you've got ADHD and or autism, you will immediately go to the top of the pile and we will really think about you and consider you for interview because of the unique skills and qualities that go with neurodiversity that Katharine was outlining before. So the world, the outlook is very, very positive. And I just wanted to share that, Robin, before I finish.
Fantastic. I was going to ask you a follow-up, which actually been preempted, but some great questions coming in already. So maybe pair these two together. And I don't know if you want to take both, Colin, or pass one to Katharine, but firstly from Jenny Singh, what should schools be doing to turn around those exclusion statistics? And then for more, why can't or don't these children thrive at school?
Was that Jenny, Robin?
Yeah, Jenny's was around the exclusion statistics and what okay. Can schools do to turn those around?
Thanks, Jenny. How long have you got, Jenny? So I'm all right till about midnight. What should schools be doing? Right, Jenny, great question. Absolutely. And I think that the second question linked to that, Robin, didn't it, in that sense? Is how do children...
Potentially, it could be seen as separate, but why can't or don't
how do children thrive?
Children thrive at school?
Okay, right. Well, I think let's start with a big picture answer to this, Jenny. You know, you look at Robert Gordon College and what they're doing at the moment, the leadership that they've shown about the Umbrella Project in Aberdeen. There's an institution that's making a very public, very statement. Look at this session that we're doing right now. But an institution that is saying, look, we want to talk about neurodiversity. We recognize it. We understand the positives of this, and we want to place ourselves as an education institution right front and center within this debate. And I can't stress, Jenny, to you enough the power of that for children and young people walking into this institution and thinking, well, I'm recognized here, I'm known, and these adults are going to take this into account and are going to do what they can to make sure that I thrive. And there's a message being sent here, Jenny, as well, isn't it, to the adults who work in this this institution in the sense that, you know, for the neurodiverse adults, the teachers, and I'm very, very keen that we talk about these people, that we include them in the discussion, because again, the power of adults talking about their neurodiversity to children and young people that they teach, I can't underestimate that at all.
I was just going to say, I'm reading this book. I don't know if you can see it, but it's about learning from autistic teachers. So that's, you know, to back up what you're saying, Colin, is we need to have role models and role modeling by teachers in our education system, but also parents. So I just wanted to back up your point on that.
Absolutely. Thank you.
And I should add as well, if I can, Colin, that in hosting this tonight and doing what we're doing with the ADHD Foundation, it's not because we're saying we absolutely get this perfectly right as a school. We're very much on a journey with this too. It's just showing that interest and engagement and a desire to get better around it. And a lot of that has come from challenges we've had from pupils and parents that have said, we'd like you to be better on this. And we've listened to that. So I think, you know, a good first step is undoubtedly to listen. But it is difficult to operate within an education system that wasn't fundamentally designed for neurodivergent pupils. Yes. And that's something that we're trying to challenge as well. And it's great that we're having this conversation that spans both the world of work and education, so that we can learn lessons from each other. So I should throw that one out there as well, that we're certainly not putting ourselves up as a paragon of virtue in hosting this, but as a school that's desiring to do better on it.
And neither are we. I would just say, from BP perspective, we're really at the beginning of our journey. You know, what Colin was saying, like, I'm not underestimating. I've hustled for what feels like 4 years to get to where we are. We started off as a group of parents and carers of neurodivergent children, and that was maybe about a handful of us, maybe 10. And over the last 4 years, we've grown to over 200 members, of which more than 75% of our membership network is neurodivergent and self-identify as neurodivergent. But it's not just schools, it's everyone that needs to. So it's health, the health systems, the in our country, the industry, and you know, we're learning from IBM. There, you know, there are people out there, there are companies out there that are doing it a lot in this space, more than we are, and we're trying to learn from them. So it's about bringing industry, about bringing government, about bringing health and education together, because that's the way you turn around the statistics.
And I was just
picking up on your point before, Robin, and I think you know, having been working in this field for 7 years, sometimes I do think, Katharine, I agree with you, that we have still got so much more that we still don't understand. And if you think about how the agenda is changing already in this short period of time, the idea of comorbidity and co-occurrence, that we, you know, are the days numbered when we talk about ADHD and autism and dyslexia as these kind of, you know, separate, distinct diagnostic titles that people go down pathways, and don't we realize that everybody has a spiky profile, everybody's different. The massive increase at the moment right across the UK in that diagnosis of ADHD and autism combined, and the more I think of that, the more I think we still, there's lots about that how those two neurologies work together that we just don't understand as well. So we are all on this journey together in some senses.
And coming back to the book you recommended a short while ago there, Katharine, so a question coming in here from Steve. To what extent are exclusions of neurodiverse children the result of poor levels of understanding, training and expertise in neurodiversity amongst teaching staff and leaders? I mean, a question open to both of you there. I'm expecting an easy answer to that one, because it's definitely a tough one.
Well, a great question, Steve, and thank you for that. And I think the answer, broadly speaking, would be yes. I mean, also, I think one of the conversations I often have with educators is, you know, when they talk to me about some children and young people who are very challenging and hard to kind of engage with in classrooms, is what we're talking about their, you know, neurodiversity, or are we talking about their anxiety here as a result of, you know, unmanaged, unsupported, in some cases undiagnosed neurodiverse conditions. Is that what we're seeing? And also, you know, Robin, you'd said before about an education system that isn't geared to the needs of neurodiverse children in many ways. And there's a real lack, isn't there? There's a gap of teaching children how to self-calm, how to look after themselves. You know, we should be, well-being should be a central feature of the curriculum. You know, Katharine talked before about a curriculum that's geared towards what employers in the 21st century want, and they want people who are able to kind of be resilient, who look after themselves, who get themselves mentally and physically fit and able to do the work that they do. So that's certainly something, a part of it. But also, I think, you know, we there's lots of things that we really need to talk about, isn't it, in terms of what does attention mean and how do we achieve attention? Attentional dysregulation, or what I would call variable attention, is a feature of a whole range of different conditions. And any parent and carer, you know, in this meeting now will recognise what I'm going to say now, where people say, if you've got ADHD, you can't pay attention. Well, you know your sons and daughters. You know that there's things that they absolutely pay attention to. Goes back to Katharine was talking about hyperfocus, and that raises a challenge for us as educators, because the key to a variable attention is engagement. And I always say to teachers, you know, is how are you working to engage children and young people who are neurodiverse, because that's the absolute answer to achieving attentional regulation. And that's challenging, that is. And then, of course, there's the whole issue of memory, and we don't talk enough about that with neurodiversity, because there is, I would say, I mean, I don't know much about the Scottish education system, I'm sorry, everyone, but I think in England there's too much. There's too much content. There's too much to remember. And we need to be scaling back with that, and, you know, really having the time to go back and revisit and retrieve information and build on it and make connections. And we need the space and the time to do that with neurodiverse learners. So, Steve, you're absolutely right, is that we, you know, that there are many, many things that educators can do, but there are challenges on top of that as well.
I think just build on what Colin is saying, and to answer Steve's question in it from a slightly different perspective that we haven't really got a chance to focus on, which is, so for me, it's, we're all people, right? It comes down to the culture that we're creating, and a psychologically safe culture where we're accepting of difference, and I know it sounds like a utopian world, but for me, in my experience as a parent of a neurodivergent child, are the lights gone off again, Colin? but it really comes down to building a relationship with those teachers, and it's reciprocity as well with those teachers that really want to learn and are there and want to understand and listen and be open to a child needing. We've agreed that my son gets, you know, when the eject button needs to be pushed, that big red button for him, he knows to take himself out of the classroom and go and chat to the counselor, and then, you know, calm and then come back in again. So, you know, teaching them self, like, regulation strategies, as Colin has said, because that builds resilience. And that's another skill that we really value, is the ability to, I mean, my son's my personal resilience coach. He's teaching me a whole world about what it means to be struggling through every day and every situation. And I'd say, yeah, it's really about working with your teachers and building those relationships with those teachers, because, you know, they have such an impactful effect on our children.
I think that you reminded me of, I think, one of the most intelligent things that anyone said to me when I was first really interested in neurodiversity as an issue in education. So it's going back a few years, but a colleague of mine, who's an autistic son, certainly struggled through his entire journey in education in schools. And it was really sad to see that his parents had to battle with that. And what he said to me was that the problem is everyone keeps trying to make him step into their world. And to really understand my son, you've got to step into his world. And I thought, yeah, that's the leap that we've got to try and make. We've to turn that around to properly understand and comprehend this. And if we could maybe take a step back, it's a great question that John put in early on. And this is more conceptual, but do we have and do we need a shared understanding and definition of the concept of diversity? I could just ask you an Oxbridge-type question there.
I think in terms of neurodiversity, I think it's the more I think about this, the more I think we just haven't got the language right. The language is not fit for purpose at the moment. You look at the word neurodiversity, you know, as that as a word implies a population, doesn't it? We're all neurodiverse. We've all got individual unique brains. I personally don't particularly like the term neurodivergent because it implies that you're diverging from something, but that's just my personal opinion. Obviously, we are moving away significantly from the term disorder. And I would encourage any all of you parents and carers just to challenge that when somebody says that about, you know, your child's not disordered, there's nothing wrong with them. But who would make the decision? Look at the acronym ADHD. I mean, it's just not fit for purpose. It doesn't describe that condition at all. It's not a deficit, you know, and we need to move away from that term disorder, as I've said. So I think, you know, the questioner is absolutely correct. Certainly around neurodiversity, I think we need to understand that everybody is unique. We need the language to represent that, which I don't think we have currently.
I'm really pleased you picked up on that, because I think our language is such a key thing in creating that shared understanding that, you know, the question is calling for. I wonder if, Katharine, if you could maybe talk a little bit about the distinction between being autistic and having autism and how that can carry quite a lot of offence.
Yeah, so I guess I've even evolved in how I've described my son, who was diagnosed when he was 3 and he's now 12. For the earlier days, I actually used to say with autism, and I say he's autistic, right? There are different people. I guess the bottom line is there are people who choose to say with autism. There are people who choose to say I am autistic. There are people who choose to say neurodivergent. So I think it's about what people themselves are comfortable in choosing to describe it. You know, there are some colleagues in work. We're having a very topical discussion about whether my autistic colleagues identify as having a disability. Legally, it is the case that it qualifies as being autistic qualifies as having a disability, but actually many of my autistic colleagues don't see that. I mean, someone who's dyslexic doesn't necessarily think that they have a disability, but there's a whole wider discussion around the people believing that disability is a negative thing, right? And it's a different ability. And so it's a topical discussion. And I can give you my view and how I refer to my son and how he refers to himself, but that doesn't apply to everyone. So I think we just have to acknowledge that and sit with that a little bit.
Yes, but when I deliver training courses, I always say, you know, take your lead from the person. Whatever, yeah. How they are choosing to define themselves, it's their right to do that, and take your lead from that.
Mm-hmm. John has actually sent in a message to say that he did mean to say neurodiversity as opposed to diversity, but I think your answer certainly much put that in context.
And just to come back
his comment, his little bit to say to Katharine, he said, having worked with parents for over 40 plus years, I have a concern about the way the use of language can unintentionally exclude certain parents and individuals. So I think talking to some of the themes that you're raising there.
Yeah, even we've been on a journey in BP with my colleagues in educating and creating awareness about the use of the word. Many people don't understand the difference between neurodiversity and neurodivergence. I wouldn't have either had I not, you know, been in the shoes that I, you know, as a parent. And it's been a journey. And I guess the bottom line that my kind of ask to everyone that's dialed in is just really educate yourself, you know, read. There's articles, there's the ADHD Foundation, you know, that has National Autistic Society has a wealth of information that you can educate yourselves on. I think that's part of the journey. We all need to educate ourselves and understanding that. But I agree, a shared understanding and definition of the concept of neurodiversity, John, is absolutely required.
We are certainly getting a spate of questions coming in, and one or two of them, if it's okay to viewers, waiting for your questions to come up. I might hold back for Laura when she'll hopefully join us shortly. But one specifically that was for you here, Colin, from Julie, Do you know what training is being provided to universities? My eldest went to uni last year, recently diagnosed with ADHD. They received zero support in adaptation and subsequently left the course. They're now in a city college, which appears to understand their needs far better.
Okay, Robin, this is Julie. Very, very timely question. We are noticing an increased interest from FE and HE around talking around neurodiversity. The problem we've got, Julie, is that we just don't know, because nobody is asking universities and colleges to produce that information. I recently was part of a conference organised with our partner organisation in Ireland, ADHD Ireland, and the Irish have got really onto this. I could tell you exactly the percentage of students in higher education institutions in Ireland who've got ADHD or autism or dyslexia. We're just not asking universities to produce that level of information. So, Julie, you know, anything that I'm about to say now is going to be very, very anecdotal. My experience is that it's a real postcode lottery. It really is. I know some universities doing a wonderful job. We're working with all of the universities here on Merseyside, but it's very, very mixed. Oxford and Cambridge, interestingly, are actually ahead of the game and are some of the best institutions in the country in terms of neurodiversity. But there, I couldn't direct you, Julie, to any kind of, and please, anyone, put in the chat box if you know differently, any resources that would give you an idea of looking across the piece at all of the universities. Where should I send my son or daughter to? Obviously, the first port of call is their website, of course, and look at what they are offering. But it's certainly something that is increasingly on the agenda, not just in terms of the support services on offer, but in terms of the teaching and assessment. I was in a university in York in September doing a course on ADHD, and what we were finding was that when students didn't hand work in, the only strategy that was being offered was that they just deferred. They just gave them an extension. So what they weren't looking at was about that variable attention. Why hasn't the student started it? Why aren't they doing it? So they were having students who were just getting completely overwhelmed because everything was backed up. And they said their dropout rate was really significant with neurodiverse youngsters. Julie, just something you might be interested in. I'm about to organise a free webinar. Just have a look at our website. Somebody approached us, a just recently retired lecturer from John Moores University in Liverpool, the mother of a daughter with ADHD. And she said, I want to do a session for parents because I want to tell parents what I wish somebody had told me before I sent my 18-year-old daughter off to university. She crashed and burned within the first year. So have a look out for that, Julie. But a real postcode lottery to summarise.
This is a long comment, but I'll throw it in because it's really interesting, perhaps one for you, Colin. This is from Sarah saying, until recently, I thought ADHD was a condition associated with boys. My view was changed when I, a female, received a diagnosis in my 40s. I think I read somewhere that the incidence of diagnosis in girls is far lower than in boys, perhaps suggesting that ADHD symptoms in girls are more difficult to identify or, as I was told in my case, well masked. What's the best way of tackling this and ensuring in the college setting that all neurodivergence is identified?
Okay, well, sorry, Robin, what was the name of the questioner, Robin? Sorry.
Sarah.
Hiya, Sarah. Well done, Sarah, getting your diagnosis recently. Do you know what, Sarah? You're part of a national trend. The Guardian newspaper published an article last March that said inquiries for ADHD assessments from adult women overtook men for the first time ever in the UK this year. So it is a real trend coming out of the pandemic. Not as good news in terms of children. We're on 4-1 for children, 4 boys to every 1 girl. That's moving backwards from what we were just before the pandemic. but Sarah, there are many, many reasons, aren't there, why we are missing girls and the impact when we miss the girls. There is always a price to be paid for later identification and diagnosis, and generally that's in her mental health. Particularly, we have historical connections, don't we, between conditions like ADHD and autism with boys and men. Did you know Asperger's never worked with a girl or a woman, and some of his assessments we're still using adaptations of them today? But also the answer to it, Sarah, is that we need to raise awareness of what ADHD is and how it presents, because sometimes, you know, some of the features of ADHD, for example, can be misinterpreted in girls than it is in boys. You know, I've always been dubious about this diagnosis of ADD, because I think that sometimes female hyperactivity is misinterpreted. So girls who never shut up, girls who have what's called emotional hyperarousal, very emotional responses, girls who are hypersociable, get labelled as chatterboxes or drama queens or ditzy, when actually that's the presentation of hyperactivity in those girls and young women. And then, of course, what's very exciting in the field of ADHD, Sarah, is that we are really having a discussion at the moment about masking with ADHD. There's long been that discussion within the autistic community. We're talking about it with boys now, much more than we were in the past. And it's a real challenge for teachers, because if they're masking and very successfully masking, it's hard for teachers to identify this. But I always say, let's go back to the diagnostic criteria. If people are aware of this and really look at, you know, really look at that criteria, particularly attention, memory, okay, we can spot girls and young women. And if they're going into meltdown when they get home and the teachers are saying they've been great all day, there is absolutely something to look at there, isn't there, Sarah? But you're absolutely right. You know, we've never been in a situation where we've been as conscious of girls and women with ADHD in particular, and it is beginning to change, it really is.
Can I just add to that? Just the question is a brilliant one. And I think my personal view is that we need more role modeling. So we have an amazing, so one of my most proudest moments about being in the chair role of our neurodiversity network was lobbying right up to, so Bernard Dooney is our CEO. And at the time, our executive vice president, David Eiten, was for innovation and engineering, and he supported us hiring a full-time neurodiversity program manager in, and her name is Micah Blievenicht, and she is a rock star. She is ADHD, and we need to, and she is making amazing progress and knocking it out the park for us. And I think the way we bring that back into school is we find female role models that are ADHD or autistic or dyslexic, and really profile them and share that with our kids in schools, and really highlight that in our discussions, and make it safe for other girls to think, oh, that's awesome, like I have those traits, you know, look what I can do. And I think that is a great way of supporting, so role modeling and true leadership as well.
Lots of things coming in through the chat. One observation from Christine talking about language, as we were discussing earlier, saying we experience exactly the same journey in the use of language. It evolves with understanding and acceptance. And a point from Morgan relating to your query on universities, calling anyone out there doing it really well, saying that at RGU, Robert Gordon University, if a student tells the uni that they're neurodivergent, then it's a fantastic support service available, and each school will provide individual assistance based on the student's particular requirements. We do what we can, but as with everything, we can do more. And Tracy asking, when you say that Oxford and Cambridge are ahead of the game, what is it that makes you say that?
Thanks for the question. Just in terms of the information that I've seen and some research that I've seen, Cambridge in particular recognises that in many of its degrees, they have a very high proportion of autistic students as well. So they've really embraced that and really put support systems in place to meet the needs of those students. And in terms of the kind of students that are going to those courses in Cambridge at the moment, the actual profile of them, they're meeting directly with that, or they're just better at publicising it. So that might be another issue there as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And then a really interesting point here from Rory, saying that whilst it's as many obvious positives in terms of awareness, do the panel feel that the recent proliferation of awareness of neurodiversity across pop culture and social media channels creates a risk of damaging the status and support available for those who have greater need, by normalizing neurodiversity through, for example, incorrect self-diagnosis by individuals or overwhelming our society's current established support networks? I suppose, in summary, is it becoming trendy?
A few years ago, Rory, I was going around the UK talking to different audiences and saying there's some really exciting things happening on things like TikTok and Instagram. But I'll tell you what, Rory, I'm 56, so I don't know that much about TikTok and Instagram. I'll be really honest. All right. I just heard, and people have talked, that the voices of very, very self-assured, very self-confident people, young people, sorry, were beginning to be shown, and particularly coming from the States. There's been a pushback to this, Rory, recently. And I mean, I'll own up that I don't know the background, but I have been reading and I have been talking to people by saying some of what's being put out there now on these social media platforms is really questionable. What I'm going to say to you, Rory, is, and what I say to people when I get asked this question, is I just think there is some really good stuff out there, of course, but we have to be very, very careful now. And especially, you know, in terms of what your son or daughter might be accessing. I have heard that some of it is not as positive as it was before. Sorry, I can't give you more on that, Rory.
I think, yeah. Asks a really interesting question that I'd like to discuss further another time if I could with him, but I can only comment on and I think it's a really valid question, so I can only comment on our experience of MBP and kind of my colleagues and the support networks that we've been providing, and I don't sugarcoat the challenges that they've gone through today. And I just give one example, like we're working on in our workplace, designing our office for inclusion. And what that means is we've been working with architects to design any of our new offices with different lighting, different textures. We, in a hybrid working world where people have unassigned desks, we are assigning desks for those of our colleagues that require them or would like them. We've designed well-being spaces, sanctuaries, we call them, where you, sensory rooms, I guess. So, you know, that says to me that it's not overwhelming or kind of normalizing it or taking away the need from our colleagues with MBP, certainly. And we don't sugarcoat it. But I can't speak for the wider societal impact of what you're suggesting. And I would agree to some extent, I'm pretty sure it is, right? It's like, you know, people suddenly are saying, yeah, I think I'm, you know, I'm a little bit autistic. And I'm like, well, you're either pregnant or you're not. You can't be a little bit autistic. So, you know, and it's kind of, so I would agree. I probably think there is an element of damage that's causing, but at the same time, I can only speak for what I see in BP, and that's certainly not the case.
A point being made as well from Oregon University's Edinburgh Uni have a pre-meeting and provide supports such as extra time in exams in smallest populated room and typed entry, etc. And a question here from Susan, she's asking specifically about schools, but we could perhaps broaden that out to the workplace as well to extend what you've just said there, Katharine. How can schools help kids who are struggling socially due to ADHD or autism traits?
I mean, do you want to, great well, time, Colin. I'll take the question each time, and then you come in. there's many ways that we schools, but parents and adults can help kids who are struggling. There's lots of different practical tips, examples where you can provide agree certain accommodations with the school and coach strategies. I mean, like, it's really simple. It's also my son, at the beginning of the year, he made a little bit of a collage about what makes him him and also what autism is. And it was a 2-minute video he shared at the beginning of the year with his classmates so that they could understand why he's different, why he stims, he talks to himself and he'll pace back and forth. And he's totally okay with doing that during recess and not hanging out in the playground with the other kids. And by just sharing that information with the class, you know, the kids got him, they get him, right? I'm not saying he's not subject to comments. I mean, comments in the playground, but it goes away to sort of helping the other kids understand, socially why he's different. That's in partnership with the teachers, right? That's in partnership with the schools. And that's in part educating yourself. We say, like, ideally you walk a mile in a person's shoes and then you can really understand. I think it's very difficult for people if they don't have any experience in this space, but you can educate yourself and then you can work with the school and the teachers specifically to help the kids in the class. And by making it general, it doesn't have to be all about your child. You know, you can have social lessons and examples as well. So that's what I would say.
It's a really good question earlier on from Gemma, and if Laura is able to jump in, and then we'll ask her this too, perhaps. But how do we get teachers to understand masking? And again, to broaden it out, perhaps employees as well, Katharine.
I'd love to say that, you know, in an ideal world, no one masks, right? It takes an enormous amount of effort for someone to mask. As they say about kids, they go to school, like my son will go to school and he holds it together the entire day, masks probably quite a lot, and then I'll come back and release, you know, you get this kind of totally different child. I'm interested, first of all, what Colin says from helping teachers understand the masking piece before I comment even more.
Mm-hmm. I will say, actually, if we can jump in before you answer there, Colin, that something I've come across a lot in my career is teachers that don't believe a child is neurodivergent or has, or is, sorry, autistic, because they just think, well, but they're fine when they're in my classroom, they're fine. It's not getting the masking aspect and the effort that goes into that that causes some of that confusion or lack of support. Sorry, Colin.
Okay, Robin, can I just go back on the previous question and then move on to masking, because we were talking about struggling socially. One of the best ways that we can support children and young people who might be struggling socially is to understand, you know, emotional dysregulation and how that is impacted by neurodiversity, and also to understand that developmental delay, why some neurodiverse children might present as more immature than their peers, which can lead to bullying. It can lead to social isolation, of course. And I'm very, very passionate about what opportunities are schools offering children who are neurodiverse to learn how to self-regulate and to self-calm themselves. I mean, some of this is about great practice that goes on with quiet spaces, as Katharine was saying, and low arousal spaces, opportunities for children to deregulate. But some of it's about movement as well. We don't let neurodiverse kids move enough in schools. And if we understand the neurology of dopamine and the function of dopamine, we can't plan lessons where youngsters are expected to sit for the whole of the period, especially if they're neurodiverse. And also, how many opportunities are we giving them to talk as well? You know, why does your child talk so much if they're neurodiverse? That process of externalizing everything, of sequencing your thinking and your understanding, which other children might be doing internally. So I often say, let's create classroom cultures that are full of movements, that are full of talk, that are full of opportunities to calm and self-regulate. But also, we've got an early years team. We're probably the only ADHD charity in the UK that's got one. They do a lot of work on emotion naming and emotion coaching strategies. And I would encourage any of the parents and carers to have a Google of that and find out what about that is. Because if children are existing on that high level emotionally, they're highly anxious coming into school every day, then sometimes they don't know, do they? They don't know how they're feeling. I did a conference in Gloucester recently with a teacher who had a selfie station in his classroom with a class of 10-year-olds, and he used his selfie station for them to kind of Brilliant. Look at themselves and think about how they're feeling and recognizing that. And he said that was working really, really well. I think going back to Catherine's point about masking, one of the strongest strategies we've got is that close relationship with home and school, because is the school really aware of the different presentation at home? And any child that goes into meltdown consistently when they come home has to be looked at by the school, even if they have been absolutely no problem during the day. And I want to move past this idea of challenging behavior, that challenging behavior or not, the absence of it is the marker of whether somebody's neurodiverse. Because if I think if we're really looking at children really carefully, we have to see poor memory, don't we? We have to see variable attention. We have to see low resilience and, you know, other presentations of anxiety. And these are all ways in which, you know, we can get an idea about whether or not somebody is masking or not. And then just plain exhaustion, as Catherine said, you know, at the start, is are you seeing different energy levels through the day? Is the child exhausted at the end of the day? Well, why compared to everybody else? Why is she more tired? And I must just back up what you said, Robin. I've had heartbreaking conversations with parents where they've said, my child absolutely is autistic or has got ADHD, but it's not going to go anywhere because the school won't support me in this, because the school are saying that they're not seeing it. It is a real issue. And one of the things that the older that children get, when they become teens, when they stop understanding whether they're masking or not, because it's just so routine for them that they don't even understand in some cases that they are masking, because it's just routine for them. But I would certainly, you know, those things that I just said then in terms of things to look out for in terms of potential masking.
Mm. And actually raised a really interesting point there about parents. And again, this is a question for both of you, but what support is there out there for parents who are fighting all of these battles over small things, big things, over an extended period of time, and just feel that school views them as being that parent? You know, how do they get a bit of support to help themselves cope?
Yeah, where do I start? Yeah, it's like what Colin said earlier. I could talk about this for until midnight. Find your community, find other parents, other warriors, right? And because you're not alone, I guess that's the first thing I say to anyone who's sort of starting their journey in this space with a child who might have just been diagnosed. You're not alone. And I have found comfort and resilience in my community of parents, and, you know, sharing ideas, what's worked, what hasn't, you know, providing a sounding board just to listen. I think, I think that would be my first point to make. And then really educate yourself, because I think, you know, data, statistics, anecdotal evidence, everything you can find to support your case. So you go in, the psychologist in the States where we were living when for the last 7 years, she got me this book, which is about moving from emotions to advocacy. And it is a very emotional, your child is a very, you know, of course you're totally emotionally attached to your child, and it can be very emotive. And so I think it's about trying to move to a point where you're almost you're the advocate rather than the emotional cat, around that. So look after yourself. That's the other point. You know, as a parent, I've been hustling for years, and you really have to, someone said to me when I started this journey, pick your battles. And in the beginning, I was picking every battle because I was like, I need answers, I need action. And sort of over time, I've understood where I'm going to get the most value, and actually, frankly, where my son is going to get the most success and support. And so you do have to choose your battles. So look after yourself, you know, because they need you. Choose your battles and educate yourself as well.
I wish I could actually just spend time reading through all the comments that are coming in, and people are sharing their own individual stories and still posing questions as we go. We're going to overrun it by about 5 minutes. You never know, we might get a guest appearance from Laura, but if she's busy at Parliament, it means that good things are happening. So let's see that as a positive. But a question here, or a point and a question from an anonymous attendee saying, fantastic discussion. I'm wondering what support has been given to the staff in educational settings or within businesses in order to accommodate and provide support to such a wide range of neurodivergent individuals. As a parent of a dyslexic child, I often feel that I'm placing an additional burden on teaching staff, and being within the education sector myself, I often feel overwhelmed with trying to provide the right support to the right student, as guidance in this area is rapidly challenging. I think that's a really good point. I'll throw out perhaps one suggestion before Katharine and Colin, if you want to jump in on that one too, but certainly the amount of professional learning that's been done on this has increased, I think, significantly. And I've seen a really positive change in my time in education, which is just over 2 decades, that before, anything to do with this would have been the SEN coordinator, the SENCO, support for learning, however it's styled, depending on where you are. And that for the rest of the staff, there are kind of 95% plus of them, it's like, that's not my job. If there's an issue with this, you go to the SENCO. And that's not the case at all now. I think all staff do understand that they need to upskill in this, and they need to be aware of the needs of all the pupils in the classroom. I think that's one of those positive changes I've personally seen within education. That's not to say that we're getting it right yet, but it's heading in that direction, and that is a good thing.
Can I just add something there? One thing that we are about to do, we've got a first session on the 7th of February, is to provide a series of discussion forums and webinars specifically for neurodiverse educational professionals. Because you listen to Katharine and what's happening there, and that's not really happening within the education system. And if there's one area of the our society that should be getting to grips with neurodiversity, isn't it? It's with the teachers and the support staff. I've lost count of the amount of sessions that I've done, and I talk about to school teams for 2 hours about ADHD. Somebody comes up to me at the end and turns their back and drops their voice and says, oh, I've got ADHD. This is one of the teachers. And you think, why are we whispering? We've just been talking about it with children for the last period of time. So there is, we want to step into that space. Also, what fascinates me is why is being neurodiverse makes you such a great teacher? And I know outstanding teachers who've got ADHD or autism or dyslexia. Brilliantly. But also, I think also what the question was saying, when you said additional burden on me in terms of I would hope that any decent training that you receive on neurodiversity really should not feel like an additional burden. It's about looking at how we approach things, looking at how we tweak. Our work is rooted in what can you do tomorrow as a teacher in your classroom with the space that you work in, the number that you've got, the course that you've got to deliver. It's not asking you to do something more that feels burdensome. It's about changing and adapting what you're doing within the conditions that you've got. But I do understand it can feel overwhelming at times. I do understand that.
Yeah, and then just to kind of build on that a little bit, it's just, you're not a burden, so keep going. I think society is changing, and it's not going to happen overnight, and it is changing though, and people's perceptions and attitudes and are changing, and I think we just need to, I need to keep going. So that we don't feel it's a burden, and that it is celebrated. And, you have to see it like that. Change the narrative. It's not a burden. It's a privilege to work. I can't tell you the most amazing team I have worked with in my entire career has been on as part of this neurodiversity network. I've worked with people who are autistic, ADD, ADHD, dyslexic, dyscalculia, and I can't tell you that has been the best experience ever, the best diversity in team thinking, and blown me away. So it's about changing the narrative and sharing that rather than seeing it as a burden. Keep going.
Can I ask you just to pop up that book again? Somebody's asking about the name of it.
Oh, that book. Yeah. So it's Learning from Autistic Teachers, How to Be a Neurodiversity Inclusive School. And it's edited by Dr. Rebecca Wood. But the other book that I referred to about moving from emotions to advocacy.
Oh, actually, that's the one. Yes. Sorry.
Yeah. I'm not in my house at the moment, so I'll come back to you. I'll take your name from the list and we'll share that afterwards, maybe in
it's an anonymous attendee, but if you're still with us, okay. Anonymous attendee, could you message the school and let us know who you are and we'll pass that recommendation on to you. And looking at the time, we've got really, really 1 minute left. So can we just throw one final question of the many here? And I'm so sorry, by the way, if you were desperately hoping that we'd ask your question or share experiences, because honestly, we've done a lot of these webinars and I've never seen the chat look anything like it. My hyper-focus has failed me on keeping up the thread. But one final one from Rebecca. How beneficial is taking a trauma-informed practice and approach within a school to neurodivergent pupils?
I would say yes, absolutely. If you look at the fundamentals of trauma-informed practice, I get a little bit worried about some of the discussion around trauma and neurodiversity. I don't automatically think being neurodiverse is automatically traumatic. And I know some of that is part of the discussion, but it can be. And it can be. And that the experience of school with other factors in a child's life can be traumatic, and neurodiversity can be part of the mix with that. But looking at your policies, looking at your practice, and seeing to what extent is school re-traumatizing children, not the opposite, I think is absolutely valid thing to do. But also it seems to me that the basis of trauma-informed practice is that there is at least one adult in that building who gets you, that you can go to, that you can talk about, who understands you and has got your back. And I think if every neurodiverse child has that within a school as a starting point, then that's absolutely a positive way forward.
I don't know enough about trauma-informed practice to be able to answer Rebecca's question directly, but I will just say this for those of you that haven't had your question answered, I'm more than happy if you reach out to me directly through LinkedIn or otherwise. I'm happy to give my email out to the school and you can reach out to them, and I'm happy to continue the conversation because I think this is what we need and we need to keep the conversation going. So I'll end with that.
Thank you so much. I mean, I honestly feel we could have run until midnight quite easily, and maybe we need a sequel on this one. Laura does send through her apologies. She is busy in Parliament and she'd love to join us tonight. And I held back one or two of the questions that were specifically around education reform, exams, curriculum design assessment, which is a whole huge area that we still need to unpack. But what we will do is write up an article about this. We'll include links to books and blogs that have come up in the discussion tonight. And hopefully we'll be able to share the recording of this as well. So just a huge thank you to our panelists, Katharine and Colin. You've been absolutely amazing. There's a lot of really positive comments coming through on your answers in the chat. So thank you everybody at home for being so engaged in this and taking us a step forward in our journey about raising awareness and understanding so that we can make things better, not just for the neurodiverse community, but for everyone. Thank you very much for joining us tonight.
Thank you, everyone.
Excellent. Thanks a lot.
Please take care.
Bye-bye.